It's my pleasure to bring Don Crafton to the stage, and he will present the Distinguished Career Achievement Award this year. So come on up.
Call me Don Aldo. I'd really like to acknowledge my committee of renowned scholars and wonderful colleagues who helped me with this. Vivian Sobchak, University of California, Los Angeles, who sends her regrets today. Linda Williams, University of California, Berkeley. Ian Kaplan, Stony Brook University, and Jan Olsen, Stockholm University. I'd also like to thank the dozens of people who obviously put in a lot of time and put themselves out at some risk to nominate our colleagues for this distinction. It made the committee's work both easier and more difficult at the same time, but I want to thank you for that. The phrase curriculum vitae means course of life. Looking at the 50-plus page CV of the recipient of this year's Distinguished Career Achievement Award makes it clear that his academic life has been more than the average thoroughfare. It's a mighty freeway, replete with elevated overpasses and cloverleaf interchanges. I was in LA when I wrote this. Ranging from early cinema, avant-garde production and film and the other arts, popular science, and detective fiction as genre and mode of consciousness, his interests and expertise seemingly show no limits. His self-described specialties are problems of film style and interpretation, film history, and film culture. His published work has concentrated on the culture of modernity from which cinema arose. He relates it to still photography, stage melodrama, magic shows. He looks at wider cultural concerns such as the tracking of criminals, world expositions, and spiritualism. He developed the concept of the cinema of attractions, but let's not hold that against him. This rubric remains the single most effective and widely disseminated heuristic for understanding, discussing, and teaching not only early cinema and the avant-garde, its original application, but for comprehending many other interdisciplinary phenomena associated with epochal changes and experiences of time, space, and technology in modernity. His two published monographs set the standard for culturally and theoretically informed scholarship. His D.W. Griffith and the Origins of American Narrative Film weaves a narrative, his phrase, between the early productions of this complex filmmaker, the industrial and economic background of his cinema, and how these forces influenced storytelling innovation. The films of Fritz Lang, Allegories of Vision and Modernity, uses close viewing of the director's work to reveal Lang's obsession with the mechanisms of looking and showing, and aligning them with an overarching sense of morbidity and a reflexive meditation on the process of interpretation. The true scope of our recipient's contribution to our field emerged, however, in his manifold essays and invited lectures. He has written over 100 published works and delivered many times that number as lectures. His ubiquity has not exhausted his originality, his ability to look at social phenomena in a new light, or to see the previously unseen in quotidian modern culture. Nor has it used up his energy, mirth, skill at oration, and wide-ranging curiosity. In the late 1980s and early 90s, to give an example, while his definitive essays on attractions were emerging, he was also writing and lecturing on George Landau, Ernie Gehr, and Hollis Rampton. Flash forward to the present. While he's working on a book on the invention of the moving and technological image, he has also published on topics as diverse as color, cinematic and otherwise, animation, truthiness, and Erich Rohmer. Our recipient has been widely recognized for his scholarship, including the Society for Cinema Studies, when it conferred its dissertation prize on the thesis that was the basis of the Griffith book. He was awarded a Guggenheim Fellowship and was an early recipient of the Jean Mitry Prize given by Le Giornate del Cinema Muto. He received an honorary doctorate from the University of Stockholm and received a Mellon Distinguished Service Award that included a grant of $1.5 million. And in 2010, he became one of the few scholars ever inducted into the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. His remarkable creativity and intellectual curiosity render him an invaluable scholar. His revisioning of the social impact of early cinema may be his most lasting achievement, but indeed, everything he writes about or lectures on opens new avenues of thought. It may be safely said that everyone in our field in some way has benefited from or has been influenced by him in their writing or thinking about film and culture. He is to film studies as John Lennon is to music, and as Charles M. Schulz is to comics. It's fitting, therefore, that the Society for Cinema and Media Studies awards the 2015 Distinguished Career Achievement Award to the Edwin A. and Betty L. Bergman Distinguished Service Professor at the University of Chicago, Tom Gunning.
Well, I want to thank Don in particular, but I have to say, George Harriman, not Charles Schulz, please. And actually, Bob Dylan rather than John Lennon. Anyway, as I should warn you, if you aren't aware, I'm supposed to talk for a while here, so I'm going to. I feel bathed in thankfulness, not only to this organization and the people who thought of me for this award, but to all those, too many to mention without gravely overlooking some, who helped me along the way, mentors, colleagues, students. To avoid sounding like I have mistaken this occasion for an Oscar award speech, I will mention only mentors. My advisor, Jay Lida, who embodied film history. Annette Michelson, who made me rethink the way I saw movies. The archivist, Eileen Bowser, who inspired me to excavate as well as view. P. Adam Sidney, who focused me on the possibilities of vision. And Noel Birch, who showed me alternatives within film history in Japan and early cinema. Two recent losses also stand out. A little longer ago, but still fresh for me, the late Miriam Hansen, who brought me to where I am now. And more recently, the late David G. Leahy, professor of classics and religions, who taught me as an NYU undergraduate how to pay attention to texts. Now, I have to confess that SCMS conferences have always made me confront a certain ambivalence I have about the academicization and professionalization of media studies. I have to acknowledge that I, like media studies itself, am a child of the 60s, and that I always bridle at protocols and formalities and certain uses of language that seem to me to be tools of power, even perhaps especially when engaged in the critique of power, supposedly. I mean, after all, if we heard of a working situation where people were busy from 9 a.m. to 7 p.m. without a lunch break, wouldn't we sign petitions? I hope we can make this very important event maybe a little less inhuman, but it is very important. And I apologize here. I'm not very good at professionalization, as I say, and I have no way to figure out how to fit in lunch. So, frankly, I never anticipated when I entered NYU's Cinema Studies graduate program at the beginning of the 70s that it would lead to a career. It was, quite frankly, a sort of ruse to convince my family that going to an average of 3 movies a day, something you could do in New York City, was not a neurotic practice, but a course of study. But it would be more than bad faith and ingratitude not to acknowledge not only what I've gained from academic institutions and the way they facilitate knowledge, a debt exemplified by the many great papers that I've heard at SCMS through the years, and this year in particular, and the exchanges they've promoted. I recall a moment in David Leahy's class in the late 60s during the invasion of Cambodia by the U.S. forces when a group of protesters entered the classroom to urge us to join the protest outside and became engaged in a discussion about the implications of Achilles in the Iliad had to the current situation. A couple of them refused to join the conversation and stormed out. I recall Leahy's voice calling after them, "Stick around, you might learn something." In many ways, it serves as an allegory of my own experience, a feeling of ending up somewhat illegitimately in a classroom, but then sticking around and, yes, learning something. What is it we're learning? And here we can have my first slide. It's always seemed to me that it would be a grave loss if the cinema, and by that I mean the panoply of moving images and light-borne devices, from the magic lantern to the video touchscreen, not just film, if this became just another academic topic, rather than an enigma whose central address and use of technology provides a clue to modern existence and a challenge to our traditional ways of thinking. As a child, I was fascinated, intrigued, occasionally deceived, and sometimes enlightened by the light images coming from screens all around me. It seemed to me I did more than watch them. I dwelt upon and within them. That has never changed for me. The cinema, the light-borne, moving image, is clearly a medium for many things. But it is fundamentally the manner in which it transforms whatever message it might carry that I feel should truly engage us as scholars, as I believe it does as viewers. Now, I realize, as Mr. Crafton said, that I am fated to have my name eternally wedded to the term cinema of attractions, a term which my dear colleague Andre Gaudreau, who I understand is holding a rival conference at the other end of town right now, my dear colleague Andre Gaudreau and I devised in the 1980s to articulate the uniqueness of the early cinema that we'd been exploring together since the 1978 FIOF Brighton conference. I confess, it does sometimes seem like an albatross around my neck, and Laura Mulvey and I have at points mutually commiserated on the fate of being identified primarily with one single essay. And I confess that her essay was an inspiration for mine, and I found a great affinity with the attempt to reconceive cinema's address in terms of a gendered spectator rather than a universal one. Now, I have no desire to distance myself from a concept that I continue to find central to what I learn and what I teach about cinema. Somewhat polemically, I claim that the attraction of cinema, the light-borne moving image, precedes its involvement with narrative and ideology. Precedes in what sense? Well, partly historically. Cinema, I still claim, first sought to display light-borne moving images before it told stories or made ideological arguments. Secondly, and more dialectically, I claim that cinema carries a perceptual attraction before it carries a message. Now, this can be tricky, since narrative and ideology are modes of apprehending the world as much as a content to be conveyed. I do not truly claim either can be eliminated entirely from our engagement with either an apparatus or an image. Thus, my claim of precedence here is a bit polemic. Instead of starting with narrative form, instead of beginning with a reading of ideology contained by the apparatus, I feel we must begin with the experience of cinema, the fascination of its elements, which implies both captivation and wonder. Thus, my interest in early cinema is more than archaeological, and its ties to the avant-garde for me are less than accidental. I often feel, in fact, that the key role the avant-garde played in both Laura Mulvey's essay and mine is overlooked in the rush to apply them to dominant cinema. Let me be clear. I would consider in many ways the bulk of my work to be an explication of the role of narrative in film. From my discussions of the way that D.W. Griffith's Biograph films undertook the task of narrativization of early cinema to the way that Fritz Lang's cinema produced allegories of modern life. But narrative in its contact with cinema involves more than schemas of anticipation, delays, and fulfillments, which it shares with other media. It involves fundamentally a radical transformation through the moving image and its own modes of fascination and wonder. Early cinema displayed these negotiations with great clarity, partly through the lack of certain narrative tasks, while the avant-garde cinema has often undertaken the task of stripping away our narrative expectations and conventions to see what lies beneath them. Now, I came to cinema studies at the origins of its institutionalization and academicization, even if, as I confessed, that was not what really made me enroll at NYU. It was an era anxious to establish that cinema studies was more than cinephilia and that it had theoretical chops. It was an exciting period, and I was swept up in the atmosphere that the teachers I've mentioned created, with the sense that something new was being founded. Does anyone today look forward to the arrival of an issue of a film journal the way we used to anticipate each issue of Screen in the 70s? At the same time, I often felt that my sensibility ran against the grain of much of this current. Even as I encountered and sometimes resisted theory, it sharpened my sense of what it was I wanted to study. The dominance of what retrospectively we call apparatus theory was formative for me in many ways. On the one hand, I felt it was pernicious, an exercise in bad faith by scholars who renounced the effect of cinema's psychological indoctrination embodied in the very act of watching a projected moving image, even as they exposed their willing students to this danger. I felt that the sense of wonder that drew me to cinema could not simply be understood as enthrallment, an updating of the confinement within the illusions of Plato's cave, in which the inmates now needed no chains and even purchased tickets to their own imprisonment. But of course, the profundity of the ideological critique, and I do believe it's profound, lies in its exposure of a modern willingness to captivation, even if, to my mind, the critique maintains an implicit elitist claim that somehow the critics are immune to these charms. The penetrating critique of grand theory by Bordwell, Carroll, and others showed the fallacious aspects of many of its arguments and liberated the realm of cinema studies from an allegiance to a doctrine that I often found stultifying. What was called the historical turn seemed to open new riches and complexities for investigation, including early cinema. However, while the call to move our field away from a unified theory to more modest tasks of research and problem solving seemed therapeutic, I now worry about its long-range stunting of the basic questions of our field. In fact, I would call for a return to an in-depth investigation of the apparatus, using precisely those skills that the second generation stressed of historical research and close analysis, but not renouncing a broad view of what cinema might be rather than simply what it is. If the cinematic apparatus can be probed for its effects, aesthetic as well as ideological, liberating as well as enthralling, and placed within a modern history of both technology and perception, stylistics and aesthetics, I feel our field would be revitalized. Now, I do not claim by this last statement that this is not already happening, and I know of many examples that I've heard even just this week in the work of many scholars, but rather I'm calling for its recognition and perhaps to encourage its ambition. Essential to my understanding of media history as not being simply a face turned towards the past, but an activity taking place in the present, aimed towards the future. My interest in turning to early cinema in the 70s lay not simply in a curiosity about the primal scene, but precisely to think around the aporia I saw apparatus theory driving me into, the fallacy of the dilemma of insisting that cinema was either a good or a bad object. Avoiding this literally infantile approach did not mean abandoning a critical view, but rather founding it in a new way and avowing, rather than disavowing, the fascination of the cinema without simply celebrating it, although I think celebration has a place too. In an era of new media, cinema history cannot be simply a nostalgia for a lost past. The mission of the Theof Brighton Project in 1978, into which Gaudreau and myself participated while we were still graduate students, was articulated by Eileen Bowser and David Francis as looking at old films with new eyes. I would claim further that we saw early cinema as new eyes, as a new way of perceiving and presenting the world. I claim that the novelty of motion pictures is not only something that is still evolving as cinema blossoms into new media, but that its history as well is still being discovered and understood. I feel much of film history and film theory unwittingly tried to tame this novelty, trying to see cinema as a new version of the act of representation that the art supposedly always undertook. Even the apparatus theorists saw cinema as old as, well, Plato's cave. Rather than recognizing its radical transformation of our practice of image making, our goal now, partly inspired by the protean energy of new media, is to sense the persistence of this novelty. As an enthusiastic participant in the ongoing return to the writings of André Bazin, I'm inspired not by the supposed naive realist who believed in the myth of total cinema as the duplication of reality, but in the theorist who proclaimed at the end of that eponymous essay, quote, cinema has not yet been invented. Our task is to keep pace with this radical new invention, and that must never mean allowing any amnesia about its past. Okay, in conclusion, I want to end with a plug for my newest book. Like the concept of the cinema of attractions, it's a collaborative project coming from close interaction with an archive, in this case, the iMuseum in Amsterdam, Netherlands, and a group of scholars, archivists, and artists. This is a book primarily of pictures, and I know there are copies of it here, I believe, and I hope people go and look at it. And although it does contain essays by the historian of film color Josh Meeby, the archivist Giovanna Forsati, visual artist Jonathan Rosen, and myself, the book is called The Fantasia of Color in Early Cinema. This is, to my mind, a dream book in the sense of trying to render vivid and visible the way that applied color of early cinema, non-photographic dyes applied to the surface of individual prints, evoked a realm of fantasy, especially in the trick and fairy films of the cinema's first decade, but also in films of travel or scientific observation. You can have the next slide, actually. Has the back, and I hope you can read that I've got endorsements there to give you a sense of the range from Guy Maddin, the filmmaker, W.T.J. Mitchell, the theorist, and Tony Orsler, the crazy artist. So. Color is the most elusive of technological elements and exemplifies the hybrid nature of early film culture. These colorful films are one of the hidden delights of film history, a unique sensual depiction that aspired to be a collective dream. That this work deals with still images from movies is part of its secret. Each image is a fragment of a larger film, and juxtaposed, they make us imagine a film we could never literally see, but in which we can dwell and dream, perhaps forever, or at least as long as they're preserved. Thank you.